see an alien terraform factory here on Earth. You know, they get to go into the bowels of that, and they get to see the aliens not as a guy in a rubber suit, but as a fully computer-generated being.
The making of the arrival. The making of the arrival. Alien weaponry in the arrival includes the sinister imploder ball, a hybrid of light wave and black hole technology. Digital animation.
What we begin with on this particular shot were four empty plates. And the imploder, which is this round ball, also had a rod in it, which first of all had to be removed. This whole plate was morphed and warped. And then on top of that, we added all of these items, 3D, the paper, the face coming at us, the scarf, the red scarf that you can see up here. And to this, we also added interactive light, where we see the flashing and we have the background so that when things are happening, they're flashing, and it really makes these things look like they're within the same world, like they're in the same environment.
We were given reference photographs and other photographs that we were able to scrounge up from some of the work print that we were provided with. And I was able to build models to scale in the computer with the 3D program, meaning that this desk measures the exact desk of the one that you'll see flying around the room. They would tell us, well, it's 5x4, or this tank weighs about 20 pounds or whatever. And I could just build all of these things to scale so that when we put them into the set, they look like they belong. We also built models of the actual set itself so we would know exactly how much room we have to physically fly these things around and know what artifacts in the room themselves, such as pillars or beams or stairways, would catch the shadows that we necessarily had to represent to make these fake artifacts look like they belonged in the actual plate that we got. You can fly each individual object, keyframe each individual object, so that when you're done, they will follow their keyframes religiously, frame after frame after frame, scene after scene, take after take, and physically go in and extract a performance out of an inanimate object the same way that you would have out of a regular character.
Digital compositing.
The character of Zane Zeminski descends into the alien terraform factory. And we see some things that we don't even understand and can't even begin to understand. We see other things that begin to make sense and tie into the larger story, the story of global warming as well.
The illusion is created by photographing a miniature with a motion-controlled camera and then re-photographing Charlie Sheen trying to simulate the same motion. Putting the two together, putting a real human being in there as a scale reference that kind of fools you into thinking that that little stadium, that little model is as big as a football field. Well, Charlie Sheen is on a set. He's in this tube, and there's a background that's shot at a completely different place. It, of course, has to either bounce with the tube or bounce in an opposite direction of the tube to look believable. And at a certain point, we couldn't just talk about it. We had to say, what does it look like? Which way is the background going to move if the camera shakes with a guy standing in a tube? And what happens to the background if the tube shakes relative to the guy standing in the tube?
The alien creatures have a biology completely different from our own, revealing an exotic anatomy made possible through digital artistry.
You knew, didn't you?
There's three pieces of that shot. There's a background, there is a mechanical set of legs, and then there's a human being. All three elements have to be combined, put together to look like they were shot as one element. We put a building in a part of the world that it didn't belong. One of the shots of the alien leaping in the air, he's actually got two wires hanging from him that are actually pulling him up out of the frame. We take a slice of the background and put it over on top of those wires. You never know they were there. And that's what we do.
Miniatures.
The best compliment you could get from a model is somebody to say, wow, that was a great shot, how did they do it? Not, oh, that looked like a great model shot. The reason something looks like a real object in a movie is there's some sort of object, no matter what it is, that somebody can identify with scale, whether it's a fire hydrant or a mailbox, or if it's an airplane, a gangway, a ladder, something that looks like, oh, I've seen something like that before, and that's obvious that it's 10 feet tall or what have you. It's when you're dealing with spaceships or something that's sort of otherworldly that's difficult, because there's nothing in it to really give it scale.
If that's it, how big does that make that?
So it was about 8 feet from platform, just the top of the platform to the top of the building, and there was about a 3.5 foot sort of wood scaffolding, so to speak, underneath it. You had the building, and then you had the antenna, which was about 9 feet tall, and then there was an additional, probably about 6 or so feet below that to allow the thing to come up out of the ground. So because it was so tall, and the shooting stage ceiling was only about 14, 18 feet, we had to shoot the whole thing on its side. And that way you were able to have as much linear movement, which would be transferred on screen to up and down, which now has become side to side. But it's wood and plastic and metal. It's just like set building. Granted, they're urethane foams you use now that they didn't have 20, 30 years ago. But still, it's plaster, wood, drywall screws. Nothing really changes that much over the years. Just the technology.
The making of the Arrival. Sound design.
If the soundtrack leads me into the focus of the film, that's what I consider a good soundtrack. So, in essence, you shouldn't have to listen for anything. The sound should be an experience of its own. We start with two different sections, dialogue and sound effects.